Hello, my name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm a systems engineer at SUSE, and I'm also the team leader of the future technology team. And in long tradition, I want to give an update about what my team did in the last year and on what new technology we are working. So, for the one who don't know me, the agenda will be something we call Paranet Secure OS, Secure Device Onboarding, and Micro OS TIO. But starting with Paranet Secure OS. If you have a team working on several topics which would end in a common product working together, it's always good to have a global goal people understand and see where they should work. Where the work should end. And after being in quite some discussions with partners and customers in the last 12 months, there was something common topic, which I called the Paranet Secure OS. It's coming mainly from the hardware vendors and customers using Edge and machine learning. And they're really afraid that somebody is able to steal their machine learning algorithm, while the machine, edge machines normally are somewhere outside, far away, and not always as good protected as it should be. So the common requirements are that you should not be able to intercept the boot process, to then call your own commands, whatever. That if you power on the machine the first time until end of life of the machine, everything is fully attestationed. So every step of the boot process must be anchored in a hardware-based root of trust. And if something does not fit, they want that the hardware will brick itself so that nobody can do anything with it. If there is any intrusion attempt right from outside, it should also brick itself. Of course, you need to make sure that not a denial of service attack leads to this device bricking, but that's then customer requirements. And the most important part, destroy all data at end of life of the hardware. With the old magnetic hard disk, it's quite simple. You overwrite it. With modern SSDs, it's more complicated. That's why they want to have it fully encrypted everything so that you cannot do anything with it even if it is not fully destroyed or deleted the data. And if somebody get physical access to the box and rips out the hard disk or manage to create an image from it, you should not be able to access any data on it or execute it on another box. And since this bricking of the machine can happen if somebody attacks the device, there should be a recover facility. One hardware partner is thinking about SDO and UEFI firmware. According to his own words, he is already working on it and has some ideas. That's something which will not come from us. My team concentrates on remote attestation currently. So we did use Keylime for it. It's a small upstream community. We have one person working actively there. Meanwhile, Alberto, and that's working pretty well. So Keylime is doing method boot. So when the booting machine is sending all hashes to another instance, so a remote one, which then verifies that everything is okay. And the same is not only for the boot, but also for executing binaries. EMA is in use for it, and currently they add support for EVM. So if you install a script, a binary, or something else, which is not known to the master, the machine will be bricked and all other machines will be disallowed to communicate with this machine because most likely Trojaner or something else got executed there. You can install encrypted payload on these machines, so some kind of secure device on board. There's a revocation framework with user-defined plugins, so that you can block access or whatever you want to do. There's a REST IPE for different clients to communicate with the server, from the clients to the server. It's mainly written in Python. The client agents are currently rewritten in Rust, which is good because we don't want a big fat Python stack on the edge nodes, at least not for micro SRC micro. And that's work in progress. And it's already fully integrated into the OpenSUSE MicroS product. So if you install from DBD, you will see system roles, which allows you to set up a Keylime agent or Keylime host. So what does Keylime exactly does? It tracks the hashes from the kernel measurements against PCRs from the TPM chip to have a golden value. It validates that the measurement boot lock event logs created and compare them if everything is fine. You can deploy a user-defined policy to validate the event log. You can generate good hashes for binaries and use EMATPM to monitor them. That is what already said. If you execute something where the master does not know the hash from, then this machine is listed as hacked and bricked, if still possible. If not, communication with this machine is forbidden. And there's a full talk about this from Alberto on Friday at 11 CET, CST, if you want to know more details about it, how the TPM exactly works, Keylime works, and what he is working on. Another part of this is full disk encryption. So if you encrypt the file system and you have a remote server, you don't want to send out a technician every time you have to reboot it to type the passphrase. So you combine the boot measurement with the TPM chip and hashes so that if the boot measurement is okay, the TPM chip will give out the hash to unlock the file system in an easy way spoken. There is a proof of concept already built with Kiwi of OpenSUSE MicroS for this. There are two things to consider. If you build an image, you have to re-encrypt on first boot the whole image, as the same key is used for all images, which means if you get access to the master image, you can decrypt all file systems. That is not what we want. And LUX2 is required for it, but currently we are still at LUX1. Just work is under the way to enable LUX2. I'm not sure if it is already there or not, but at the beginning it's only a testing option so that we can continue our work on it, and GRUB2 also needs more work in this area. While the installation is really simple, the big challenges only happen afterwards, because you don't want to deploy the system every time again if you have an update or if you need to update the firmware. But if you update the system, especially the kernel bootloader, or if you update the firmware, the hash will change and the boot measurement will fail, which means the TPM chip will not give you the hash to unlock the file system. Another big problem could be rollback. If you have a running system and then do a rollback, the measurement hashes changes again because you have an old kernel. The question is, do you want to allow it or not? On the one side, if a new update is broken, you want to do a rollback to an old good snapshot. But on the other side, if the old snapshot contains a remote root exploit, you don't want in no way that somebody triggers a rollback by some means. And since it's also a big topic, Fabian will have a talk about this, about transparent disencryption on Friday after lunch. So if you are interested, watch him. He will explain it in much, much more detail and deep. The cool device on board. Edge and IoT, how is an onboarding doing today? In the most cases, you have to coordinate technicians, the IT network guys, security operations, operational teams, so that the technician has access to the remote site, can plug in the machine to the network. The machine needs an IP address for the network. The operational team need to know this is really the new device I should use and integrate in my system and everything, which opens a lot of challenges. Some I told, so device identification, data privacy, tracing ownership of the device during distribution, the cool communication between device and cloud configuration, and of course the configuration of the device. There is a secure device onboard protocol, or better, there are meanwhile two. There is the old SDO, secure device onboard ecosystem, mainly created by Intel and later hand over to the Linux Foundation Edge group. Meanwhile, there is a new standard, or it's currently written and created, that's the FIDO secure device onboard. SLI Micro and MicroS is coming with the old SDO client, but we have already the new FIDO client and are currently submitting it to the products so that you can use the old or the new one depending on where your customer is using in his environment. So the core device onboarding should do, the device is shipped to the point of installation, connected to the network, powered up. The device established a trust connection with the customer device management services and will be provisioned. And this is all in a way that it is always identifiable who made which change and where the device is. In the graphic, you have a manifest and you have a device. And this both are distributed on separate ways. So you will never find the keys or manifest for the device in the near of the hardware, so that if somebody steals the hardware, he still has no access to it. If somebody has a manifest, then as long as you don't plug in the device, nobody can take it over. So, and you have at first the IoT device manufacturer who creates the device and the initial manifest for it. Then it's going to the distributor, who is installing the system, also adds his key to the manifest. Then you have the system integrator, and then you have the IoT platform service provider. They all counterfile the root trust, and in the end, if the technician switch on the device, it will configure itself. It will create a trusted communication with a cloud of the service provider to get its initial configuration and data to then connect to the cloud of the customer so that the customer can take over and knows this is my machine and nobody made anything with the machine, all the boot measurements, everything is still fine and I can trust this device. We have an AutoJust file which for the initial installation of the Micro or MicroS, which also asks you during installation for the serial number and model name so that you can really create unique devices. So what else did we work on? Transaction update was rewritten in C++ after it was a big bash script in the past. It's also allowed to create a shared library, libtoolkit. There are meanwhile connectors, for example, for PackageKit in the work. There's code, but from Baxilla, it looks like that's not all problems solved, but we are working on this. There is SE Linux support, and we have now a DBus interface. The DBus interface is important if you want to use Cockpit, for example, that we now can write a transaction update plugin for Cockpit and then communicate via a one-to-one web interface with the machine. So we also reworked the handling of ETC and the overlays. We only have need now two overlays always. So this long list of overlays you saw maybe in the past is gone, which also lead already to the problem that the list got too long for the buffers. Another project we are working on is something like RPM OS 3 status, so that you immediately see which base system was installed, what was additionally installed, and where do we drift away from it. Currently, it's an experimental feature of transaction update with a status call. But Alberto is working on Rust bindings for libRPM and similar things, so that we can create an own standalone tool of it. And I know, I think it's the third or fourth implementation that maybe this time we avoid the mistakes of the old one and it will really work and provide better output and support. Something from my last hack week, there I started MicroS as transactional image update. Image in this case means not a raw disk image, which you deploy on an empty disk and boot the system, but image means slash user as image, so that you can only exchange the system, but don't need to reformat everything, and you really update the image. Why did I start playing with it? If you look at safety certifications, especially for cars or trains, there is nearly no way around such images, especially if you have a huge amount of identical hardware. On the other side, many customers on conference and sowas always ask for images. But I have to admit, the two main reasons I always hear is the first one, image-based deployments saves you QA. Nobody was never able to explain me where it really saves QA there, because you have to test the same things as before. The other second main reason or argument I always hear is to avoid that different installations drift away after an update. I can understand if they fear that with a package-based installation, machines have different versions of the package installed. But if you do a snapshot-based release like Tumbleweed or MicroS, it's quite simple to create a release package which hard requires exact versions to avoid that. From my experience, the last years with S3 I was involved is the main reason normally is an admin made a change, did test something in ETC or VAR and forgot it later, and then half a year later it created problems. And an image-based update will not help you at all here. Another problem with images is you lose all flexibility. You have your fixed image and you cannot install anything additional on it or something similar. One of the main reasons why Red Hat changed with RHEL Fedora Atomic in the past from a pure OS 3 to an RPM OS 3, that you still have the ability to install the RPMs you need for logging, for additional hardware, extra hardware, whatever. Another disadvantage is, or I think it's really good because it requires strict separation of configuration files in etc, variable data and var and user. So quite of our packages who really mix it up in a terrible way will not work with this, and it's good reason to start cleaning it up. And of course, if you do image updating, there is no pre-post installation or an installation or update possible. So no pre-post scripts. They are executed if you build the image, so they will configure the system according to the Biltos, but not the final system. And you have no access to anything outside of user during image building because you have no access to the client system where it's really installed. So everything which makes any modifications outside user, especially in etc or var, has to be created at first boot, and the best way to do it here is systemd. Now we have a problem. We can, of course, use user only as image and only change that with an update, but not the root file system or root subvolume in this case. But if you have to do a rollback because the new update was not okay, then the new update could already have modified etc during the first boot. And if you only roll back user, your configuration files in etc will not be reverted. So in most cases, this means the system will still not work even after a rollback because you have a configuration in etc which does not match /user. For this reason, I played around to get two snapshots on two devices or file systems in sync. And one solution was here that the root subvolume references /user in etc fstep with the full subvolume snapshot path. So /user.snapshot/1/snapshot will be modeled at /user and not the device or file system itself. That works fine with some drawbacks. One is if you create the snapshot to update and you make afterwards modifications to etc, all changes after this snapshot creation are lost if you reboot. So the same problem we had in the beginning in TrapMIS transaction update, where we solved it with overlay file systems. I don't have a good solution yet. I want to avoid the overlay file system mess, and I'm not sure if it really works here. So we have now two snapshots to keep in sync. Snapper by default cannot do it. So ButtFS file systems don't know of each other. So the root subvolume is handled with snapper-like snapshot and rollback on slash and open the tumbleweed in the same way. The only change we made if we create a new snapshot is to adjust the slash user entry in etc step. If I find a way to do create the snapshot and the etc step modifications from the init RGD at the next boot, that would be really helpful, great, but I still haven't found any good idea here. So that leads to the problem, our changes made to the root subvolume will go lost after the snapshot is taken until reboot. For the user snapshot, there is now real snapper support to handle it because snapper sees it as standalone snapshot and not connected with the root file system. So what needs to be done is I need to write a script which is going through the root subvolumes, look at etc steps there, write remembers all snapshots of user which are in use, and then deletes all user snapshots which are not referenced in the root subvolume anymore. And else the rollback is done on slash and OpenSUSE. You create a new read-write snapshot and mark it as active with snapper rollback. And the user stays, there will be no second snapshot or new snapshot because user is read-only and is immutable with this, so it always stays as is, and there is no need to create a new snapshot or something similar. As I said, one pre-requirement is that everything is in slash user, and thanks to Ludwig, who finished a really, really old OpenSUSE project, user merge is now finalized and done. So if you look at a current OpenSUSE tumbleweed or microOS, you will see everything is in slash user, slash var, or etc. And the last two points, we need to work a little bit more. But var isn't that bad. And there's only compat siblings in the root file system, except user and the other directories, which are not really parts there. For the etc directory configuration files, I introduced 2 years ago the user etc approach, which means etc only contains hospital specific configuration or admin made changes. So you have an etc host, you have an etc resolve conf, etc fstub. But if there is no change to a config, the main config of applications should be somewhere below user. There are already quite some applications who are following this. There are a few which don't do. You need to learn to use a mouse, that's a button. And so there is a list of packages which are really problematic currently. The biggest problem is grub, because grub has an etc grub.d script. The first problem is if I deploy the user image, I have no etc. So I need to copy the scripts currently from somewhere else. And if the scripts are modified in the package, they will not be updated in etc because etc is not part of the user image. Even worse is update alternatives. Etc alternatives is required to execute really important binaries like bef. So if you don't have an etc alternatives, nothing is working off the image. And Adam, not in my team, but he started a nice project, libalternatives, in the past. And currently, my team is trying to use that and replace update alternatives, at least for the minimal base system, so that we don't have to fiddle around with update alternatives to get the system installed and booted. Another problem is the module tools, which requires RPM. But there is no RPM database. We do image-based deployments. So that's a pretty useless requirement. And if you call RPM, it will fail in this case. And the really worst thing is SE Linux, which is installing everywhere where it shouldn't do anything. Red Hat solution is move it away, copy it back. Worst case, override changes of the admin. So I think, but this will really be a huge amount of work. The SE Linux library should be smarter and also separate between the distribution defaults and the user made changes and merge them at the start. Other problematic packages are based with files like etc bef-rc and etc profile. But these are hard-coded in so many places. I have no resolution how to put them in somewhere below user. The worst thing is these are no real configuration files, but most likely they should stay the same way as we deliver them, because they will read .d directories to get the changes merged. We don't have tcshell or kshell in the image currently, so that's why I don't list in their configuration files. Audit has its etc audit and etc audit p directories. Kony has etc kony conf, kony d, kony keys, where kony d is not really a problem, but a good thing. But I think we package there some files, default configuration. I'm not sure if etc kony d would then really be the right thing here or another solution. And libcontainers common, if you use Podman, it has everything in etc containers. And if you update Podman, then it has no access to etc containers to update that directory. So my current workaround is that systemd temp files at first boot, symlinks everything from user share factory etc for the installation part. Another outcome of this project is setup disk. It's a small, but meanwhile no longer so small, command line interface tool for disk partitioning and formatting. Or in other words, it's a Python frontend for lib storage ng. So it can do the same as just storage can do, more or less. Not everything is implemented. But this allows you to partition the disk, create the file systems, create the butterfs subvolumes, everything up there, and so that you really have everything and then can deploy your image on /user and don't need a raw disk image with partitioning and everything. You can provide your own partition layout in a YAML format. The default, if you don't provide one, is a microOS TU layout. And we want to make it a standalone project because we think it could be useful for even more things. But we need a good, a little boring. So if you have a good name, please tell us, and then we will happily create a standalone project out of it so that you can use it for other projects. So how do we store the user image? If you want to install or update, you need to get the image from somewhere. And if you look at AirSync, you have a daemon running somewhere which creates load on the server, and it's hard to set up mirrors and so on. Further, that's not what we want. There's a nice tool called CLSync, which creates addressable storage blocks. So that's that you have either a tar archive, which you then untar, or a remote trunk store, and then you only install or pull and install the blocks you really need and which have changed. It has butterfs support for reflinks and subvolumes, which is really good for this. But unfortunately, the development stopped more or less for it. So if you look at it, there hasn't really happened a lot in the past. And there are a lot of bug reports and pull requests open. So if we want to continue this way, we need to invest into this tool. But currently, I don't have really somebody with the knowledge to take over more or less a maintainership here. And I haven't found something similar which allows to retrieve blocks or funks from a remote server via HTTP. So that there is nearly no load on the server and no work to be done except copying once the funk store there. So from this CLSync archives, either the tar archive or similar to tar or the remote trunk store and index files, I create something I call TO archives. So all TO archives are SQUAFFF images protected with DM Verity. The archives have a header which contains which TO archive format this is and the DM Verity have. What is missing is a GPG signature for the header to be sure that not somebody replaced the DM Verity hash and made something bad to the image. I tried it, but my crypto knowledge, especially about libcrypt, SSL, and what else there is, wasn't yet good enough, and I didn't have the time to go deep enough into it to do it myself. So if someday wants to help here, has a good solution or knows of a ready-to-use solution, I'm always glad about help here. So the archive contains the manifest, which describes which OS version and architecture this archive supports, where to find it, so the full archive name, and if it is a tar archive or only the index file. The tar archive is very useful if you do a fresh installation because you need anyways everything. If you do updates, then the tar archive is overhead because you have to download everything. And in worst case, how about 95% of it because you only need 5%. So for the update case, I would always use the remote func store with the index file to only update what has really changed here. And of course, the manifest which I supported is important to know if the system which is currently installed can be updated with this image or not. So how to build and tar this thing? I have a Kiwi file which takes OpenSUSE MicroS installation and releases them as tar archive. And then there's a Kiwi post-processing thing which moves etc to user fair factory and removes everything except user. And of course, it also removes user local and then creates the TU archive from this user. It's all done automatically in OBS. So every time our tumbleweed release managers release a new snapshot, a new TU archive will be built and you can use it for installation or update. The installation is also a simple call. You install TU install, you provide the device which should be used. So what's currently still missing is a big warning that this device will be completely, all data will be completely removed from this device. You will use the full device and nothing is left over there. So it will not use a free spare part of the thing, but the full disk really. So you can specify an URL to the TU archive. If not, it's coming with a config file which points to my home project where you can currently find the archive. You can also find there an ISO image and Pixie boot image for the which launches a small installer, which more or less only contains a TU install command so that you can set up the disk, which will then set up the disk, if you call it, create a directory and symlinks in the root file system subvolume, set up Snapper. Setting up Snapper is not yet fully done because I'm still struggling with read-only and read-write subvolumes, snapshots. It extracts user, it populates etc. So creates the users and groups for the initrd, configures the network, and finishes the Snapper setup. Installs a bootloader and then you can reboot. The update is as simple. You call TU update optional with an URL to the TU archive. It will create a new, there are two new subvolumes for the root subvolume and user. It extracts the user in the new user subvolume. In the new root snapshot, it will adjust etc fstub and update the kernel in the boot directory, updates the bootloader, and makes a new snapshot the default for the next reboot. So currently, /boot is part of the root subvolume. If we introduce this full disk encryption, it could be that boot needs to be an extra partition, not encrypted. That would be then the next challenge to manage three subvolumes or snapshots together so that always the right ones are used here. And a big drawback I saw already several times during testing is self-update of the TU command is not possible because it's not a package, it's the full image. So I'm looking at if it isn't possible to put it in a container or something similar running on it to make it simpler to have the newest code and don't need to do a reinstallation to get the fixed tool. There are many resources. You can download the slide deck to look at them later. And during the week, my team will have 5 more talks going more into detail of what I talk here at high level. So Richard, Ludwig, Ignaz, Alberto, and Fabian will explain the details, much deeper, more details than I did in this talk. So now we can come to the questions. I think Hannes had one.
Yes, I had. So have you looked at Butterfest Send Receive for your TU stuff to creating subvolumes?
We looked at it, but we had to skip it at that point in time because it's we had in that time ETC in the image and had to some way to exclude it. I have to look at it again. I'm not that sure how Butterfest Send Receive will behave if you have a different old state in the user. So you don't have always the newest one, how to do that best. But
well, with the user merge,
in the next hack week.
Yeah, with the user merge should be possible, surely. I mean,
yes, but the user merge isn't as old as the current implementation of TU. Right. As I said, for the next hack week, I need to look again and send receive. But the current project was mainly started and done before we had the user merge.
We also had a problem when I was looking at send receive sort of alongside this, where we've discovered that sending the same subvolume over and over again doesn't actually produce a reproducible subvolume. There's a nice bug where it can sometimes randomly change some attributes that you're not expecting.
For which you, of course, filed a bug.
Which you, of course, filed a bug, but I do believe it isn't fixed yet.
Right.